Hello viewers, today I'll talk about how to quickly make supercharged vermicompost. See, there are a number of videos available on YouTube about how to get started with vermicomposting. There are several how-to tutorials available for making different kind of compost bins or tars. After watching all these videos, I started normal composting and vermicomposting a year ago in 2016. Where I realized that composting is a mere waste of time and vermicompost is the only go-to thing when you need a super rich organic fertilizer in a very short period of time. See, composting really takes a long period of time in comparison to vermicomposting. Okay, a few days later, out of curiosity, I started looking for how to make vermicompost better. See, we already know that, and it has been proven several times, that the vermicompost is the best organic fertilizer till date which can be produced naturally. See, here I am not talking about those organic or biofertilizers which are prepared in labs or industries under controlled environment. When we are talking about natural production, vermicompost is the best and the way to go. But the question here is, how to make things better than the best? I mean, how to make the best organic fertilizer a better one by adding some extra nutrients or supercharging it by increasing the microbiological activities. All the videos or blogs or articles which I came across suggested to use some additives to supercharge the vermicompost, but many of those additives were not available easily or are expensive. For example, peat moss, rock phosphate, bone meal, or some of them use oyster shells, etc. There are many of them which are available over the counter but are expensive. So let's get started with supercharging the vermicompost, making the supercharged vermicompost without any expensive things and with general household things. Let's get started. Here I have segregated all the additives in parts where we'll be traversing in a progressive manner from left to right. You can stop at any part you want. I mean, you can also choose your parts whichever you like, or it will be better if you take all the parts seriously and include them in your vermicompost bin. Okay. Also, I'll be giving a short and sweet reason for considering each thing to be an additive in this process. I'll also suggest the replacements or additional additives which could have been part of this but aren't available to me as of now. So here, number one is dried cow dung. This is basically a sufficient meal for your worms to thrive in. They will love to eat this. It has got almost all the required micro and micronutrients, and this will make the major proportion of my vermicompost mix. Okay. Alternatively, you could have used the waste of chicken, goats, sheep, rabbits, or maybe you can search over internet about what all animals' waste are fit for your compost bin. Number two is a mixture of green and brown waste. Here we are trying to maintain the carbon nitrogen ratio, as green being the nitrogen part and brown being the carbon part. Here we have grass and leaf clippings in the greens and shredded newspapers and cardboards in the browns. So number three is banana peels. I have put them to rot for a couple of days, hence the black color. Actually, the bananas, those which are treated with chemicals for looking good in the shells, won't turn black in a day or two. So this was basically a safety measure to prevent my worms from any unwanted chemicals. These are amongst one of the quickest degradable kitchen waste and are too soft, sufficing the basic requirements for anything earthworms love to eat. In addition to that, these peels are rich in potassium and magnesium. You can also use banana pieces directly. Your worms are going to love you for this. You can replace these with spinach, grapes, watermelons, tomatoes, pumpkins, etc. for potassium enrichment. Make sure you remove the seeds before tossing them here in the compost pile, specifically those which have small seeds like that of tomatoes. They sprout in quite quickly and you will end up having several tomato plants all over your garden. Number 4 here is jaggery. If you are here in India, you will find this easily over the counter for a very cheap price. We call it gud here. It provides essential minerals including iron, potassium, magnesium, manganese, etc. The benefits beyond the minerals are the natural sugar content that will feed the microorganisms in the compost. The readily available sugar content will skyrocket the microbial activity, and by skyrocket I mean that all the good bacteria in the compost are going to multiply exponentially. The main idea behind adding this is to increase the microbiological activities, which in turn will accelerate the process of vermicomposting. You can replace this jaggery with the over-the-counter molasses. You may want to add some organic molasses, and that will more or less do the same thing. You'll get similar benefits out of them. Number 5 here is the flour. We are using two types of flours here. The first one is whole wheat flour and the second one is gram flour. We are adding these for providing micronutrients such as zinc, magnesium, copper, iron, manganese, etc. They also contain traces of potassium and phosphorus, and sometimes they really contain more than traces of these minerals. But what I have noticed here is adding flour to your bin will keep your earthworms healthy and active. They are going to multiply faster, they are going to eat faster, and they are going to remain happy. So adding flour is good. There are some precautions, I'll let you know. But as a replacement, you can use any kind of flours like corn flour, or maybe you can grind your oats. You can use your oatmeal. Okay, and let me talk about the cautions. You need to be cautious when you are adding flours to your compost bin, because they are sticky in nature, and they may suffocate, they may stop the airflow into the bin. Okay, so other thing is the rodents love flour and can easily take over your bin, so you need to mix it thoroughly into the mixture. You just need not put it over your heap and leave it there. So you need to mix it. And the second one is saving your earthworms from getting suffocated. You just should not put your flour over the heap and pour some water. That will seriously restrict the air from reaching inside your compost pile, and it may result in suffocation, which may indeed result in the earthworms leaving your bin. So the bottom line is always mix it thoroughly while adding into the compost bin. Number 6 is beach sand and local soil. So we have a 1/4 glass of beach sand, which would serve as grit in the gizzard of the earthworms. In layman's terms, this will help earthworm in grinding the food particles, as they don't have any teeth. Okay, and for the soil, the local soil, any local soil, you may have a black cotton soil, or the red soil, or anything, any of the soil which is local to your city. The local soil has to be collected from under a tree. Select a tree whose leaves are not collected when they fall and are allowed to decay under the tree itself. You may find this in abandoned places, abandoned plots, or government areas, or maybe you can find them in the forest. Okay, so to avoid this expedition, if you happen to mulch your garden with organic matter like wood chips or dried leaves, you can grab a handful of soil from under that mulch. The whole idea behind this is to accelerate the microbiological activities in our compost by bringing in the beneficial bacteria. There are plenty of bacteria under that natural mulch. If you are unable to find this soil, don't just add any soil from any other source. It may not help, rather it may act adversely. As the alternative of sand that we talked about earlier, you can use fine grounded eggshells and well rinsed coffee grounds. These are the best thing you can use as grit. Actually these two are not available for me, so I'll go with the sand. Number 7 is neem. Adding neem leaves to this mixture makes the end product a combination of fertilizer and pesticide. It considerably reduces the impact of unwanted pests or rodents, etc. You can also use neem fruit pulp and crushed neem seeds, believe it or not. Earthworms love neem leaves and its seeds. There were studies conducted in some institute which said that those earthworms which were given neem leaves and seeds to feed were breeding and multiplying faster than those over on a regular diet. So it is a win-win situation for you if you add neem leaves or seeds, or maybe both. Okay, so let's mix these ingredients together. I'll add a couple of glasses of water or maybe more to just moisten the mixture. We don't want to make it too moist, otherwise worms will want to leave your bin as soon as they are introduced here. Also, we don't want to keep things dry as they don't like it either. I've used a variety of worm bins and worm towers, but this one is my favorite due to its shape and ventilation it provides. This is a bamboo basket, thoroughly washed and dried out under the sun for hours to remove any unwanted smell. I'll put some bedding at the bottom and will cover the walls with paper towel for making it a bit of cozy environment for the worms. They are eventually going to eat this paper towel and make room for them for the passage of air through this ventilation. Let's put our mixture into this basket, and I've already moistened the paper towel with some water. Now the time for the introduction of the worms into this bin. I'll separate our mixture with the worms with a nice moist paper towel and we'll leave it to them to choose their own sweet time to enter our super mixture. They may take a few hours, but eventually the process is going to start. Don't worry about that. They are going to penetrate through this paper towel and they'll enter into the mixture. I've noticed that if we put them directly into the mixture, a few of them tend to rush away and try to escape. Whereas following this method, I've never seen any worm escape the bin right after their introduction. I'll put a layer of vermicompost over this tile and let's bring in the earthworms. See, the worms I am using here are Indian blues or Malaysian blues. I'll put the scientific name in the description. I just forgot the name, it was a difficult one to remember, but I'll put it in the description as soon as I recall it. They are originated from somewhere around the Great Himalayas and have migrated their way to the countries around it. I prefer them over the likes of red wrigglers or the African night crawlers because these are the local worms and they do thrive well in the Indian weather. After the introduction of the worms, I'll cover this with a piece of cardboard and a moist piece of cloth. That's it. We are good to go. Well, that's it then. I'll post another video for the updates on this bin. Hit the like button below and also subscribe us for such informative videos in the future as well. See you then. Bye-bye.